Hey everybody, P.A. Turner, executive producer and host of your Break It Down show. Look, yesterday we talked about emergency management. The day before that, we talked about the Roland 808. Today, we're going to talk to, and actually someone from that Roland 808 session, a guy named Jamie Hartman, who is a nationally, internationally renowned producer. He's produced people like, Jennifer Hudson, Kylie Minogue. You can look at his Wikipedia page and just go, oh my God, this guy has done it all. Jamie is a super cool guy. So he actually, this is pretty neat. I got a chance to visit him at The Village, which is a recording studio in the Hollywood area. And it was super neat to look around there. And you see like platinum albums from The Chronic. You see Heart on the wall there. Smashing Pumpkins have recorded there. Everybody has recorded at The Village. And that's where Jamie does his work when he's on the West Coast. He's also English. So sometimes he's over in the UK doing things. It's a super cool conversation about England, modern music, how we do things here, how you stay hip when you've been around in the business for a while, and what's coming up. I just love the heck out of who Jamie is and what to do. He's easy to find on social media. You can go on Twitter. You can find him there. You can go to his website, jamiehartman.com. He's not hard to find, and he really does fantastic work. And I promise you've heard a lot of his music because he's sold millions and millions of records. Hey, if you love what we do here at the Break It Down Show, here's how you can support us. Tell a friend. That's what I'm going to ask for today. Just tell a friend. Tell one friend today. Say, hey, do you ever listen to the Break It Down Show? Man, you ought to check it out. Just do that. If you do that, you're golden with me. I really appreciate the support. Now, the last thing, as always, we talk about charity. Look, if you're not into Save the Brave and it's not your kind of thing, and you're not sure what to do, but you want to do something for charity, give a charity on top card. Go to charityontop.org. You buy a gift card. It has charity on it. It has money, $5, $10, $25, whatever it is, and send that to someone and say, hey, in this time of need, bam, here's some charity for you. You can send it to any charity you want. So basically, you're buying a gift card, but you're giving the gift of charity to someone, and that's pretty cool. If you want, you buy that car, send it to me. I'm going to put it at Save the Brave, savethebrave.org. That's our home charity. Hey, thanks so much. Here comes Jamie Hartman.
Lions Rock Productions.
This is Jay Moore.
This is Greg Proops.
This is Jordan Harbinger.
This is Dexter from The Offspring.
This is Nathan East.
This is Sebastian Younger.
This is Rick Moranis.
This is Stuart Copeland.
This is Mick Gillette.
This is Andy Summers.
Hey, this is Skunk Baxter.
This is Gabby Reese.
This is Rob Bell.
Hey, this is John Leon Guerrero.
Hey, and this is Pete A. Turner.
Hey, this is Jamie Hartman, and you're listening to the Break It Down Show.
We're in here in your studio in LA. There are a bazillion platinum and gold records on the wall. The only other place that I've been to that had more records on the wall was Allie Willis's house.
Okay.
And she's, I don't know if you know, but she's passed, but she had so much stuff, and her house was like a museum to kitsch, to like just the zeitgeist, right? There was like James Brown, combs and hair oil and all these other things in there. And then also you look up and you see a whole wall of massive hits, September and all these incredible songs.
We haven't got them in this room. We got a few bits and pieces, which is fun, but this building I love because it's really the home of a lot of LA music history. It's quite well embedded in this building, even in recent history, as well as back into the 1950s and early 60s and Fleetwood Mac and all these amazing acts.
Yeah.
Earth, Wind & Fire came through, everybody in that, and then more recently, it's been wonderful to see, we had, just before the Grammys this year, we had Dre honored here.
Yeah.
So you had Jimmy Iovine and you had Quincy Jones and Dre all in the same room.
Right.
Saying wonderful things. So I love the energy in this building. It's incredible. I'm very lucky to be here. I wandered in, happened upon this place five and a half years ago.
Yeah.
They had a little room downstairs, and I was like, I've got to be in here.
Right.
So I've been here since.
Yeah, the music is in the building. And when you walk up the stairs, there's Heart.
Yeah.
There are records on the wall. There's The Chronic.
Yeah.
It's on the wall. All of these things have roots here. It's wonderful. What are some of the things that you see going forward that's being created here? You talked about your new artist. Let's talk about her.
Well, for example, let's take Celeste for a minute. I'm not sure whether I can probably play a couple of little bits. But for me, what's lovely is always what I look for in a new artist is, and my main thing in the last 10 years has been helping to find and define new artists' sounds and how they put their records together and what they want to talk about. It's kind of been a thing for me. Rory Rag & Bone Man was one of the big ones for me,
right,
which is wonderful.
Yeah.
And I'm very grateful for that. But then also there are other artists. There's an Australian kid called Conrad Sewell who I introduced him to the guy, and he wrote Firestone for Kygo, which was a big record. It was Kygo's first single. And Celeste is one of those people that when, as soon as you hear her voice, you go, oh,
right,
we're dealing with something pretty special. And I always look for a special voice, which is a signature voice. So when it comes to working with Celeste, it feels to me like the next really big soul singer from the UK that can follow in the footsteps of Amy, can follow in the footsteps of Adele, and keep them and do them proud and you know, take that torch on.
How in the heck do a bunch of British folks sing soul music so well?
That's a good question, because we don't do R&B well. We don't get our, you know, American R&B.
And Wes also says the horn players in Great Britain are terrible. Like, they're not, they're too late. They're not loud enough. He's like, they're terrible.
I can't speak for that, but funny you say that. I just used a guy, fantastic guy. I'm gonna big him up. His name's Mike Burton, and I'm going to give you a little just taste of what he did for me, because we literally... That's the riff. Now, I used that riff on the front of this record for Celeste.
Yeah.
It's a new record that's coming out on one of the songs on her album that's coming out towards the end of this year. I don't want to diss any British horn players at all, but I was introduced to Matt and Mike Burton, Matt Cappy, two of the guys who play with John Legend. And they're just wonderful horn players. So my default guys to go to are actually Americans. So forgive me you know. But yeah, I'm not going to, but I'm very lucky to have worked with a bunch of great
British. Why good at soul, why bad at R&B? Any idea?
Oh yeah. I'm getting off point. We, culturally, American R&B is from a totally different place.
Okay.
The urban and the basis of American R&B is from these cities,
right?
From these places where it grew naturally. We just listen to it over there, and we love it, but we don't live it. We haven't lived it. It's a very different culture. You know, black music in England compared to black music in America. We love soul. We always have had as Europeans listening to American soul music, but it comes from, you know, I think we just have a slightly different take. I think soul music somehow appeals to our slightly melancholy nature.
Yeah.
And I think we get that. We do melancholy well because there's so many bloody gray skies in England all the time. It's wet and it's cold and it's dark, and we get that. Yeah. But when it comes to R&B, R&B is from the street, and the two different sets of streets, very different.
Yeah. And R&B is more like, you know, one of the guys we've had in the show is Dwayne Wiggins. He's from Tony, and he's going to sing and everybody in the house is going to get laid. You know, that's his job, you know.
Good for Tony.
Absolutely. Nice. But yeah, if you're a soul singer, it can still happen, but it's from a different point of view.
I get that. I mean, you know, the Usher, the classic, iconic, and amazing R&B artists from America, we just don't do it. We don't do that kind of sound. We love to, but we're kind of a bit garage about it. We do dance well.
No, absolutely.
We do soul.
I absolutely want to get into that, because there's someone specifically I really want to ask you about, and I hope I don't lose track on my question here. But you know what? Forget that. We'll come back to that. Okay. No, I do remember now. Okay. So America does performing artists, singular artists. Like Prince is, you know, like it's him, and he's got a band, but it's him, you know. Elvis, Michael Jackson, Madonna. If you were to rank in some crazy way, like the top bands ever, you'd have to go down the list quite a way before you got to an American band. Maybe it's the Eagles, maybe it's Aerosmith, maybe it's Red Hot Chili Peppers, but AC/DC is probably above all of those. That's a band
amazing.
The other side of the world. Why is it that British, and you know, the eras have changed, but why is it that Great Britain puts such great bands together compared to America, where it's more like a singular performer? Do you have a sense for that at all?
That's interesting. Maybe it's cultural as well, in that, you know, there's a group of kids growing up in the north of England or the south of England, and in our DNA is something that gets people in a room together to do that. Whereas I think it's an emphasis on, if you take Britain and the cynicism of being a much older culture.
Okay.
There's a tall poppy syndrome,
right? Okay.
With being an individual.
Yes.
Succeeding above the group.
Right.
which means that if you are a band, you can succeed. You don't have to be the one guy showing off, right?
Right.
You can be five guys together making music, and that's okay. And you set out as a crew, and that's okay. In America, it's celebrated if you it's America does celebrate the individual and the achievement. Right. It's kind of part of the American way, and the American dream is go get it. You know, you go and get a Ferrari, mm-hmm. drive down the street. In England, if you drive down the street in a Ferrari, someone's going to key your car when you get out of the car. They'll be like, fuck that guy. I'm sorry, but, you know, there's a little bit of the cynicism of like, it's not about the individual doing this. It's about the collective. And I think maybe there's a bit of that in there.
And do you think, does that follow to the continent as well? Because, I mean, you go an hour to the east and you can be in a bazillion different countries touring around. And again, like, if you're a tall poppy, those things get chopped. It's the same thing you think?
I think so. I think that there's just, it's like any old culture. The older they are, the more, more cynical they are a little bit about it all, because they've seen the ups and the downs of success.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, we had Drez from Black Sheep on, and he talked about, because you can't be in the rap game longer than him. The only guys before him are the originators, Africa, you know?
Bombata.
Yeah, exactly. Cool Herc and all those guys. And he's like, it's not about peaking up and being super famous. It's about, one, his powerful story he told us about his dream he has of like, he's like in the Underground Railroad escaping slavery in his dream, right? And he's running, scratched, he's all torn up. And he gets to curtains and he opens them up in this microphone. And he's like, what am I going to say?
Yeah.
You know, he's like, so it's not about sensational. It's about that long grind, going up, constantly saying something, making music that matters. And that's where he puts his emphasis. And it's easy. I can see why, like in Europe, you're like, come see us in 8 years, you know, and let's see if you're still around. Let's see if you're still alive and everything else.
Sure.
That makes a lot of sense. And then also a lot of the folks who are like, I can't be a tall poppy. They get their heads cut off around here. They come over here.
Yeah.
And they try to make it, it's all ego here.
Well, I mean, I think there's a lot of emphasis on personality in America. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of emphasis on character in Europe. Mm. Those two different things.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Purely because you have to. It's a sustained thing. Can you keep it going? How long can you do this for? Is this a career or are you just a flash in the pan? Prove it, kind of thing, and keep proving it. You know.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think you. They really respect people who get knocked down and get back up.
Yeah.
Hugely. That's the thing. But I mean, you know, in America, I've lived in America now for 10 years. I see incredible character.
Of course.
Incredible, ludicrous talent.
Yeah.
But it's just America, for example, the screen readiness and the sort of the media training in a way is built into American culture a little bit.
Yeah.
British people often, like, you see Lewis Capaldi going up to receive an award. He's a little like, nice to meet you. And anybody from any of the American writers who aren't even artists, they're like, I just want to say that. And they go in very faultlessly and they get on with it.
Absolutely. Who just won the Oscar last year? The female that played the queen.
Oh,
Coleman. Olivia Coleman. Same thing. Where she's like, whoops, here I am. okay.
It's very British. It's like, oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. I don't know what to say.
Joaquin Phoenix is there preaching at us. You know?
Right. And he's got his thing and he's written, you know, it's amazing, but yeah, they're totally very prepared.
Yeah, there is something to that. And then the thing is, this is a guy from, he's passed along, but he's the perfect American guy. His name is Carroll Shelby, and he made like Mustangs and race cars, and they made a movie about him, Ford versus Ferrari.
My brother told me to go see that movie.
It's so good.
Okay.
And he's one of those guys, he's like, I'll be goddamned if this doesn't happen. Yeah. But I think in Europe, it's more like, we'll be damned if we don't do, you know, and it's a totally different way of looking at it, not only because of the group, but the way they say we'll be damned, they'll be pulled back, whereas he's like, I ain't going that way, I'm going this way, but it's I and we, and then the escaping damnation, and like, there's no way I'll fail.
Right.
I think that there's something with our culture, and both ways are great, they both work, but it does make sense for the individual, like Madonna shouldn't exist as an artist, you know? I mean, like, if you were going to pick, like, go on, put her on The Voice or whatever, you wouldn't go, that's the person, because her voice wasn't great.
Sure.
She's, you know, just didn't quite fit the mold, but she didn't care about that.
Oh, no, it didn't matter.
Yeah, she compelled it, you know?
It's pure will. But just to that point, you know, it's interesting because I think that British, when I go now and I deal with American record labels and I deal with English, British record labels, there's definitely really, do you think you can do that kind of attitude in Britain? To like, should we? Because they've seen every pitfall. They've seen they've seen it all happen.
Right.
Whereas America's like, why not? We've got plenty of time. We've got plenty of money. We've got all the ability in the world. Let's just do it.
Yeah.
Let's make it happen. One of the reasons I do love living here, because especially in the music business, it's a tough game. And it couldn't be more like this.
Boy.
So, of course, you go to the place where you still feel like you can make it all happen, and that there's a positivity and an ethos of no, we can still do it. You know,
I'm gonna try to ask you a question. I'm not sure how to word it well, so I'm just gonna word it and just know that my intention is pure. So you're as successful as any producer would ever want to be, right? But a lot of people don't know who the heck you even are.
Sure.
You know, so if you were to tell your younger self, like, this is what's coming, and let's say that you just continue the same level of success, maybe you have a breakout thing, but you know, how many producers can people name in the first place? Does that matter to you? What would you tell your younger self? Like, you're going to actually do this. The band thing, secondary. You're really going to make your money on making other people's music. What does that younger you say? And then does he listen to you? He's like, piss off. I'm going to do what I want to do.
That's an interesting point. Because you ask yourself that. But when you get to a certain age, you're like, okay.
Yeah.
It makes a lot of sense to think, if I look back now at how long it's taken me to get here, it's extraordinary. Most people would say, hang on, but if you hadn't made it even 10 years ago, you'd have given up the ghost easily. One thing for anybody who's getting into music that I would say is that once you let go of the fact that you need to get somewhere, you're going to be fine. Once you realize that you're a musician no matter what, whether good times, bad times, you're a musician. If the world has decided, I think the music is a calling as more than it is a profession.
Right.
I really believe that. Certainly as a songwriter and as a producer, I'm more of a writer than I am a producer. Thankfully, I've gotten to production and it's serving me well now. Fingers crossed, always.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I would definitely have to say that let go of any sense of I have to get to that point in order to be happy in what I'm doing. Get happy and you will get to that point.
Mm.
Be happy in what you're doing regardless. And I never chase the radio. The other rule is never chase the radio. Find projects that truly make you happy.
Right.
Because there are so many people doing this all the time, desperate to make it work and to make it happen. You can't do that.
Yeah.
And if you're listening to the radio and you're chasing that sound, that was written usually a year and a half ago anyway.
Right.
And that record was probably produced 8 months ago.
Yeah.
And your record is not going to, even if you write it now, it's not going to be on the radio. At the very earliest, if you have an incredible moment where the label goes, this is it, it's going on the radio, even next week, still people won't probably be hearing it for months to come. And there will be other people who've already created something new. So don't ever chase the radio because it's just not realistic. Chase that little gut feeling of, oh shit, I've got something truly special on record. It doesn't matter what it is. It can be an acoustic guitar and a vocal.
Yeah.
It could be a saxophone and a drum beat. It doesn't matter what it is. Chase what makes you, what turns you on and makes you happy.
Does 18-year-old you listen to you when you say that?
No, because 18-year-old me was convinced that he was going to have a record deal by the time he was blah, blah. I signed my record deal, which is a lifetime ago, at 34.
Right. Yeah.
Right? So 18-year-old me, I was in bands. Don't get me wrong. I did have signs that things were good.
Sure.
And I won competitions and I won the national radio station competition when I was 20-ish. But thinking what has happened between now and then is just two lifetimes.
Yeah. It's the same thing with the podcast thing where I'm remarkably successful, but no one would pick that path and go, that's what I want to do. Cause it's hard, you know? And you're like, I don't know if I'm going to be able to pay my bill this month. You know, I can't, all these things that you have to go through to really slough off the competition, because the guys are like, I have to be able to pay my bills, or I have to, you know, those guys have to go away. And then all of a sudden you're like, I'm the only guy left. And then you get the phone calls, you get the projects, that kind of thing.
But you've learned in the whole process so much that you would then apply.
Yeah. So I want to get back to my other thing. One of my favorite people in music, and she just doesn't resonate here like she does in the UK and in Europe, is Kylie Minogue.
Oh, Kylie.
I love the heck. She's always on Graham Norton and she's just so charming. And I wish that we loved her more. Like, we know that she's there and she does dance music, and does she have a sister? And that's like where it kind of stops, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But then you hear the music and she still makes relevant music today, and people love it. Talk to me about her.
Kylie, I've only met Have I met her more than once in my career? My good old friend, Steve Anderson, is her music director. He's her MD. So I catch up all the time with, see the updates of what she's up to. And she's always doing something great.
Always.
Yeah. I met her, funnily enough, through Fernando Garibay, he and I and Giorgio Moroder and her did a record together a few years ago, which was an interesting thing. But what struck me about Kylie, and one of the reasons that she is as good as she is for as long as she has done it. And by the way, her performance at Glastonbury last year was the most watched of any of the Glastonbury performances.
Crazy.
If you can figure that one out. And she's but for good reason, she's wonderful. She's a serious lifelong entertainer. But what was, and I think this might be one of the reasons why, my only experience with her, she had been on four different planes. She had been in however many different countries in the world that week.
Yeah.
She walked into our studio, Fernando's studio here in LA, straight off a plane.
Yeah.
On her day off.
Ugh.
To do a song that may or may not have been a single. They liked the record. She didn't know what she was walking into. Fernando and I said, would you mind singing? And without even batting an eyelid.
Yeah.
She went, is that what we're doing? Is that what we need to do? Yeah. Okay, let's do it. There wasn't a, can I come back? Can we do this another day? I'm exhausted. She did it and she nailed it. And she is that professional and that good, apparently, all the time. And everybody loves her in her team. I know that.
Yeah.
So I think she's just one of those people that, you know, there are a lot of people who don't become global stars, even though, or they're just outside of America. They're huge. But then
So truly global, but just not big here.
But just not big here. And you sometimes get the reverse situation where you get huge American artists who I go back to England. I'm like, have you not heard of Matt?
Yeah.
I don't want to name anyone because I don't want to, you know. But you definitely get those anomalies where you think it's going to be huge everywhere. It just doesn't, it doesn't translate in some territories.
Yeah. Another guy that interests me and I just love what he does is Paul Weller, because he defies genre. He doesn't care. He just does whatever he wants to do. And
I have
so
an interesting reason why that happened.
Okay.
Straight from the horse's mouth.
Nice.
From his old manager,
who
was quite a character. I don't know if I can use the words he used.
You say whatever you want to say, it's fine.
Okay. So, this is back two lifetimes ago.
Yeah.
When I was first going to, I was with a manager and I was probably 21 years old.
Yeah.
And my manager took me to see this guy, Brian Morrison, who, you know, found Paul Weller and found the Jam and everything.
Yeah.
So, this is why they weren't huge over here, but they were everywhere else. The Jam went to Boston, played a show in Boston, 5,000 kids. It was the beginning. That was it. They had all of the major studio heads, all of the major networks there at that show.
Yeah.
And they blew the roof off the place.
Yeah.
But Paul wasn't that happy. A few friends of his had come in from England and watched the show, right? Mm-hmm. But he was being all punk about the attitude. Now, this is just from you have to take it from his manager. This is not from Paul himself. So he'd have another side to this. But he said to me, his manager goes, he described it brilliantly with a cigar in his hand. By the way, his manager was the guy they wrote Have a Cigar about. Pink Floyd wrote that song.
Yeah.
So he's a classic old manager. He's sitting there and he goes, Jamie, all I can tell you is, I walked into his dressing room. I said, guys, fuck me. We just broke America. Everybody wants to meet you. They're all outside your dressing room. And apparently, Paul Weller turned round to his manager at the time and said, I'm with my friends. I don't give a fuck. They're all C-U-N-T-S's out there. I'm not going out there. And he spat on... Oh, he didn't spit on the floor then. His manager said, what are you doing? What are you talking about? We've got to see them. We just say hello for a minute.
Yeah.
Say thank you for coming and we're done. And then they will write about you in every magazine and say, this is the next big thing.
Right.
At which point, he opens the door. Paul walks out. And goes, you're all C-U-N-T-S's, spits on the floor and goes back inside. At which point, Brian Morrison says, at that point, my hands went cold. I walked back in. I said, you idiot, you just screwed up any chance you're ever going to have a break in this country. Because none of them would write about them after.
Right.
So it's interesting. I think there are gatekeepers.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make peace and make friends with the gatekeepers in any country.
Yeah.
But especially in America, don't upset the powers that be in the biggest situation. Because of course they're not going to put you on radio. Why would they?
Yeah.
Some new band from England comes along, thinks they're the Beatles or thinks they don't have to say what they, you know, and suddenly he said that was the end of that. So that never happened.
Interesting. Yeah. So he did it to himself.
He did it to himself, according to the story.
Yeah. Well, it didn't surprise me. And he does seem a little surly. you know, and the ultimate artist, where he only wants to do what he wants to do. And,
well, you'll meet him. You'll meet him soon, and he'll come back and he'll answer and say, "That's a load of old rubbish."
Right,
didn't say
absolutely.
That at all.
Yeah.
He'll probably say the manager said that.
Yeah. And let me tell you what really happened. I was there. Yeah. That's funny. So okay, let's get more into modern times. You're basically as old as I am. And I know nothing about modern music. I am completely unhip, you know, like dad style, you know, give me some yacht rock or whatever. How do you stay relevant? I mean, I know it's your job, but like, how do you stay relevant? A lot of times the music of today, it just misses me. Like, I just don't get it, you know?
Yeah.
But how do you do that? What keeps you relevant? Talk about your ear. And
I do keep an ear open to what's going on because you have to. I don't chase what's going on at all,
right.
But you can't help but be influenced by it and love what contemporaries, as far as even not necessarily contemporaries age-wise, but people in the business are doing. Mm. You know, I'm lucky enough to know quite a few of the producers and writers here in LA and hear what they're doing, as well as the ones in London. I keep in touch with them and listen to what's going on. And fortunately, because I've helped develop a bunch of different artists,
right.
They get in touch with me with the new stuff coming in. So I get to hear what's going on. But I have to say, if I listen down to a lot of Spotify playlists, there's an awful lot of very similar sounding records to me,
right.
Which is why I think it all meshes together and molds together, sometimes in a negative way, and it's very hard to distinguish. But for me, I was lucky because my band was called Ben's Brother.
Yeah.
Because my older brother,
Ben,
sat. He would sit me down. He had played my first Rolling Stones record, Bowie. Played me, but then I went and discovered all, you know, Ella Fitzgerald, and I discovered Nina Simone. But all of these things, he said, if you're going to play music, which I did love doing from a young age, he was like, no, it's shit, do it again, something cool, make it new, make it original, give me an original thought.
Okay,
doesn't matter how you dress it up.
Nobody's
interested in hearing stuff they've heard before.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, the standard remains. There has to be something new, a point of difference in the melody and the lyric.
Hey, this is P.A. Turner from Lions Rock Productions. We create podcasts around here. And if you, your brand, or your company want to figure out how to do a podcast, just talk to me. I'll give you the advice on the right gear, the best plan, and show you how to take a podcast that makes sense for you, that's sustainable, that's scalable, and fun. Hit me up at Pete@BreakItDownShow.com. Let me help. I want to hear about it.
And the lyric. For it to stand out. It doesn't matter what form of music you're in, whatever genre.
Yeah.
You know instinctively when it's just copying something else, and you know instinctively when it's something new and you haven't heard it before.
Mm.
So it's sort of the new always stands out.
What are some of the old is new again stuff, though, that you find? Because surely sounds come back. You know, like no one's doing reverse bass today, but at some point, someone's going to take an 808 and flip it around.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And you've got, you know, those Phil Collins reverse, the drums were sensational, were amazing. I think with the right application, you know, that comes back around.
Yeah.
Honestly, it's when kids discover, or they go back and they look through. You know, they'll. I mean, hopefully, Phil Collins won't pop it very often, anytime soon.
Yeah,
he's been very sick. But when you have a popular Netflix documentary or something which opens people's eyes, and you know, people go, "Okay, wow, I had no idea that shit even existed," and they go back and look under the hood and how that happened.
Yeah,
you work with new DJs, kids who are using Ableton, kids who are using Logic, whatever it is. When you give them the tools to flip stuff. They create something. They kind of happens anyway. Because I'm sort of such a classic songwriter, I'm afraid my default positions are pretty. They're kind of universal.
Yeah.
So I still write on a piano at home in my home, and I bring that into the studio. But if I remember working with an artist who was signed to Kanye West, and I was terrified. I was like, this girl is 20 years younger than me.
Yeah,
she's clearly, you know, Kanye signed her. What the am I going to offer this girl?
Right.
But funnily enough, our old friend, the 808, came out.
Uh-huh.
And I put this little beat together that I thought was kind of cool and a chord progression. And she was off. We put the mic on. We put our headphones on. I put in this weird sound on her voice.
Incredible.
And we wrote the song like that. So invention, you know, what's the word? Necessity is the mother of invention. You have to find a way to create something new. And eventually you do.
We had a guy on the show named Sammy Nestico. Maybe you've heard of him. He has been composing for 70 years.
Okay,
he's in his 90s.
Okay.
Yeah. He's worked with Quincy. He's worked with everybody.
Right.
Was in Tommy Dorsey's band and everything. And he predates the electric guitar. So as he composes, he composes from a trombone.
Wow.
And I don't know that he's in the backyard playing trombone, but that's his home instrument. And it's in his head and plays the keyboards a little bit, but the trombone is his thing.
Wow.
I know. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
And he's like, it's a beautiful, expressive instrument. Of course you, I'm like, yeah. And with his kind of big band style music, of course, that makes sense. Big horns. Like his horn section is like five of these, four of these, five of these, seven of those. That's the horn section. And it's like, it's
incredible.
Yeah. Yeah. But what I want to ask you is as we get further along, like I'm looking at the guitars on the wall and it feels like, you know, not that we're going to get rid of guitars, but people aren't using them a lot. You know, like you hear most of the bass lines I hear in the modern tracks, it's something that's done on a keyboard or whatever.
But that's what's lovely about the cycle of the music business.
Yeah.
So for example,
yeah,
just to take you back into that for a second. I worked with this kid from Australia about 3 years ago, and his name is Sam Fisher. And this kid has just come out, and he is the number one most added song at AC record, at AC radio this week. Now, this is him in Nashville with a lovely guy called Jimmy Robbins, who I've worked with. And this is the song they did together. And this is the most added song at radio this week.
Wow. There you go.
It's all about vocal.
Yeah.
And I'm going to show you something else in a second. Covering the old heartbreaks with new tattoos. It's all about smoke screens and cigarettes. Looking through low lights at silhouettes. But all I see is lonely people in crowded rooms. Simple song.
Yeah. The city's going to break my heart. The city's going to love
me, then leave me alone. The city's got me chasing stars. Right?
It's been a couple months since I felt like I'm home.
Am I getting closer? So, where I belong, the city's gonna break my heart. She's always gonna break your heart. So that's the number one most added song at radio.
Yeah.
Say. We did a song called Smoke. You can hear the bass drum.
Yeah. Where's that from?
And then, as you get through, we did Hats. Yeah. Snare from.
Yeah.
There you go. Our friend.
Yeah.
It's all in there.
Yeah.
That's the guy.
He's playing the 808 right now.
Yeah. So using the 808s that's his second biggest song, which is, you know, on his thing. So Use It Now. It's all about melody always, mm-hmm. and a new idea, and you can still get away using the classic shit if you've got a good song.
Yeah, yeah. It's interesting, and that's a song. That style of singing is apparently always going to be around because, you know, Ed Sheeran. You can go back 5 years before that, and there's always someone that does that. You know. I don't know, gosh, you could do it all day long. You know, sure. Someone is just, I don't need a whole lot, just a snap track and a beat and then me and my guitar, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I don't think that's going to go away. I don't think it'll, you know, you'll get, as we were talking about, the cycles, you'll get bands mm-hmm. coming through again. It's harder for bands right now.
Right.
Because as you say, the guitar is kind of an anomaly right now. It's just how do we make that fit in a modern context?
Yeah.
But as you just heard, simple form. But then there's going to be, trust me, in the next 4 or 5 years, there will be the most ridiculous new edgy band that just blows everybody away. I think there will be. Wherever they're from in the world, I've heard an amazing band from down in Australia called Gang of Youths, which is mm-hmm. a fantastic band. They are out there. It's just when you get the one star like the Jim Morrison or whomever it is, the Robert Plant, whatever it is that makes that difference and sticks their head above the mm-hmm. above the crowd, that, you know. Or as you said, AC/DC.
Yeah, yeah. And their formula, like you can, all their songs are basically the same thing, but they had enough separation between them that their set is set for life. Like they don't have to.
But what's wonderful is when I'm going to do one more thing, which is right when you listen to an AC/DC record, right. You cannot get this from a fucking drum machine.
Yeah. No.
I mean, just that makes my blood start moving.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
That's a band.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what you do. I mean, forget it. Forget it. I'm in. I'm done. I saw the Killers at Glastonbury this year. We went with Lewis Capaldi, and thankfully, it was so lovely, took us there. But I saw the Killers take the roof off the whole place.
Yeah.
Because it's a great band, and it's usually a combination of chemistry between the performers that really is much greater than the sum of the parts, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And there's a couple of things I want to kind of get through and say about this, because you're right. There are the bands that, and I love you too, so I'll just use them as an example.
Yeah.
You know, when they got started, like, first off, they could barely play their instruments, you know, and then what they knew they weren't going to do was what had been done before. So the Edge wasn't allowed to do the triumphant rock solo on the guitar.
Right.
But look where he did. He completely redefined the instrument. And people like, well, he doesn't play very complicated parts. You listen to Bullet Blue Sky. Oh. Who's ever done that?
Right.
You know, and then
he's a genius.
Absolutely.
Oh, my goodness. I met him. I was very privileged enough to meet him about 6 months ago.
Uh-huh.
The guy's a genius.
Yeah.
He had his gear here. I think he was setting up for a show. But I met him through John Alasia and Lucas Nelson downstairs.
Yeah.
He came in, and what a lovely guy. But what a genius.
Yeah.
And I heard him on stage at the Madison Square Garden when the guys played there. This is almost 20 years ago now.
Yeah.
But on his own, that dude and his use of delays, he redefined what an electric guitar
He took an instrument that was well established with what you did and said, fuck all that.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Made it his own,
And the same thing with Rage Against the Machine, you know, 15 years later, you know, and it's like, what are you doing with this guitar, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I guess that always will exist. Someone will say, we're just not going to do that anymore. Like, Brian May is wonderful, but that's been done a million times, you know? So what are you going to do? Oh, well, we're going to scratch with the guitar and always other sounds.
Whatever it is. And the weight and the playing style that somebody creates and the personality. That's one of the reasons I love to use live instruments and players on my records, is that they bring personality that you're just not going to get from a machine. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter what you do, the playing and the individualism and the ability of an individual coming across on record is just wonderful for me.
As also the accidents and the unintended inspirations that happen. Yeah. Talk a little bit about that.
So I just, good, lovely timing.
Yeah.
Because I've just written a song with a guy called John Hill, who was up for Producer of the Year as a Grammy-winning producer this year. He and I wrote a song for a movie. And we've kind of went back into it with Celeste. So I'll show you what we did. Just briefly, I'm going to just open this session up 1 second and just bring up, where are we? Is there a piano on here I had? Now, where are we? Okay, I've got to find a piano for 1 second. Here it is. So we're sitting there, and it felt like we wanted to write sort of like a Bond theme kind of song, right? So we're in the key of, the saddest of all keys, D minor. But when he goes to play the key, he went like this. And I went, that's it.
Yeah.
Stop what you're doing. That is our song. And I went, and then, so that became our song.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You know, and using the mistake that he made was the song.
Yeah.
I said, dude, he went, what do you mean? He was like, oh, I just hit the wrong key. I said, no, you didn't. You hit exactly the right key.
Yeah.
Thank you for hitting the wrong key. That's the song. So that became this song, which is now going to be, please God, you know, it's coming out in however long. It's going to be, I won't play any more than that because I don't want to give it away.
Yeah.
But, you know, mistakes can be the inspiration for a great record.
Yeah, and even life mistakes. I think they're making a big leap here, but I think it's Rachmaninoff, one of those classic composers from like the early 1900s. The guy was all tore up. He's all fucked up. He's dying. He was never going to – he just blew as hell. And he's like, I'm going to do this whole concerto thing, and one of the movements is going to be in 7/9 time. So it's like a guy with like a wooden leg dancing around the room. You're like, this is so uncomfortable. It's the last music he ever writes.
Right.
And you just hear like, this is what life is right now. And you get so much out of that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Because you know who was very good? Well, I mean, Sting was very good at that. Brilliant with different time signatures.
Yeah.
Wonderful and inspiring. I think that what people constantly strive for is the point of difference, right? But they also want to use that in a realistic and creative and artistic way that's true to them. So, it doesn't matter what you do, whether you use four chords in The Truth or whether mm-hmm. you use 7-9 and go off piece and go, you know, try and descend into madness for a minute.
Yeah.
Whatever it is that gets out the feeling you have inside you of desperation to deliver an idea to mm-hmm. access, to other people and to the world, that's it.
You're a songwriter. You know, there's guys like, you know, Bernie and Elton that work together. And also, the one that I always think about is INXS, because you have, like, I guess Gary writes all the music and everything for that band, or did. And then Michael would put the words in, and then the Smolder. Yeah. You know, and that was like, if everything else he did, all he had to
if
do
there's
was,
ever been a rock star, it's right? Michael Hutchins.
Yeah.
But what was, again, that band was the sum much more than the sum of its parts. They were all incredible individuals, but when you put them together is where you get the magic, the special sauce. And one of the, there was a famous thing, there was a show in the UK called The Tube,
mm-hmm.
And people used to go on the show and perform live.
Yeah.
And one day NXS came on and they played, I think it was I Need You Tonight live,
mm-hmm.
off Kick, the album Kick, and everyone was phoning in saying, complaining because they thought that they hadn't played live. It was so tight that they thought that they just were miming to the record.
Right.
Because it was that well performed and well put together.
Yeah.
So, you know, and everyone was like, no. That was live.
It really
you
was.
You were listening to a live performance. You thought you were playing the record and they were miming. It was real. Special band in excess.
Boy, very special. Very special. And hopefully they'll get their due in terms of like Hall of Fame status, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, because just so many tunes.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, at some point,
incredible. Yeah.
And his ability to translate the music into something that mattered.
Never Tear Us Apart is an absolute masterpiece.
Yeah.
Those songs are just incredible. I have to thank my brother for that as well, because he introduced me to in excess.
Yeah. And again, like, crazy band from Australia, you know, as big as any band.
The Australians have so many brilliant bands.
Yeah. Such a small place.
Am I wrong in thinking that?
Yeah, so the NXS comes out of Australia. It's such a small place, but so many incredible bands that come out of there. And then obviously AC/DC can be anybody's top five bands.
Oh, amazing.
You know?
Yeah, I mean, just stadium level rock, but just unbelievable music and performance.
Yeah.
You know, I'm very lucky. An old friend of mine plays with Depeche Mode.
Mm.
Now, talk about, you know, classic all time.
Right.
When those level bands are the ones I would love to come back round.
Yeah.
So that I think the difficulty right now is that development
mm-hmm.
just doesn't really. It's not really as part of the record label and A&R setup. They don't really have the money to help develop bands. So they kind of have to develop themselves and be gig ready or be record ready when they get to the record label. That didn't used to happen. So bands had time to experiment and try stuff out and become special. So I think that's the only issue right now, is that it would be wonderful to be able to, you know who should do that?
Hmm.
The Spotify's of this world and the Googles of this world and the labels of this world, who really want that to a renaissance in bands.
Right.
Need to take a 2 or 3 year view that they're not going to get an album straight away. Or, you know, the first album may be a progression. Kings of Leon didn't really hit their mark in the first couple of albums, and they really hit the mark, you know. And that sometimes is the case. It's just the way it is.
Yeah, because normally you want the first three albums to be something and then whatever after that. But yeah, they went the other way. It took a while. You had to get your ass kicked on the road and then learn how to actually fill a room full of music that's good.
For sure.
Yeah, that takes time.
And do a bunch of gigs with watching other people and learn from them and get chops from other people.
Yeah.
There's nothing more informative and instructive, as I know as an artist, than standing side stage and watching your contemporaries kicking your ass off a stage because they know what's working. They work a crowd incredibly well. You know, festivals are really good at that because they just you finally get sometimes. You may not like the band or the artist, but you understand suddenly why everyone responds the way they do when you see them do their thing. Live.
When you do that here in the studio and you've got Kylie Minogue on the mic or whoever it is, Celeste, and you're trying to get that thing out of them.
Yes.
How do you get it out of them?
That's my speciality, actually.
Yeah.
For me, that's the most exciting thing, because having been a singer my whole life, I know, not trying to, you know, well, I'm not to blow my smoke up my own ass.
You're
whatever,
good at what you do.
But that really is, for me, everything about a record is capturing a vocal correctly. And I think, I mean, I had Jennifer Hudson sitting right in that seat. This room is, what, 20 foot square?
Yeah, it's tiny.
It's tiny.
Yeah.
The fact is, making someone feel comfortable enough to emote properly and not think, not overthink about what they're doing.
Right.
Make it matter of fact enough to sit them down and go and record from the very moment they are in the room. Don't get levels.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get levels.
Yeah.
Have it ready. Tony Visconti kind of taught me that. I sat in on a session
in
New York in 2000.
Yeah.
2001, maybe. I sat in on a session he had set up.
I love it.
And he had the mics ready. He had compressors ready. Everything was ready to go for this. He was recording the Dandy Warhols. They were doing a version of Neil Young of Ohio. All the instruments were ready to play.
Yeah.
They weren't, you didn't have to plug them in and get sounds. They were ready. The mic, the main room with the microphone was set up with candles all around it.
Yeah.
With three other mics in the for atmosphere, and it was ready for the guy to perform.
Oh, I love it.
And it was, and he gave performances because the atmosphere was right. And for me, this, you know, on a microcosmic scale in here, mm-hmm. it doesn't matter what song we're trying to sing or record. Someone has to feel at ease when they're in that room. There's nothing worse. I've done it when the other way around, and it's painful.
Yeah.
Trying to put, it's like pulling teeth. It's like why some of the world's biggest artists don't want to be in a room with anybody when they just want their own guy to record them, you know?
Yeah. You make me think of a story I've often told, but it's when U2 was recording No Line on the Horizon, Brian Eno had laid down a drum track, and it was all messed up. It was for a moment of surrender. It's like... And he's like, oh, he's trying to fix it before the band comes in because he's trying to have everything ready. Larry comes in and just starts playing with it. Boom, you know.
Yeah.
And then the band like comes in like off, like on stage almost, first take. And then they're all like, that's the one time when the song just came downloaded as one piece.
Right.
And that's the one that made it on the album. It's like.
Unbelievable.
Lyrics, melody.
It all just made sense.
Yeah, and Brian Eno says it's the most magical thing that's ever happened to me in studio. Do you have a story like that?
That's a lovely story. Capturing things, you know, in one go.
Or just special, like the magic moments.
Magic moments. I've had a few. I've had a few where... this song I just played you.
Mm-hmm.
I think it depends on... context. For example, I've been working with Celeste for easily a year.
Mm-hmm.
We sat down. It depends on how suddenly the elements all come together when something special happens, and it's usually, and as you just said, either a mistake or an external circumstance.
Yeah.
Celeste lost her father very young. Her A&R guy sat with us in the room and said, okay, we're nearly at the end of the record now. This is an onion. Peel off the layers. We need to get deep. We need to get real with this. And I said to Celeste, I want to bring in this guy who's a friend of mine. He's a songwriter. He and I wrote with him on his first ever co-write session, ever, however many years ago. He's English. He's coming to town. He's lovely. His name's Gary Go. I want to bring him in just to the three of us. And she was like, do I know him? And I said, no, but trust me, he's great. So we sat, the three of us, and because it wasn't quite comfortable, but because her A&R guy had said, look, you've got to get personal here. Something happened in what we were talking about in the conversation where I then turned around, played something on the piano, and she gave me enough information in terms of her energy and in terms of the way she was reacting to us for me to start this piano riff. And as soon as it happened, as soon as I sang one line over the top of it that kind of made sense, all three of us instantly just teared up. It's like we'd been joined in the room by an external force of some sort. And it was pretty much instant.
Yeah.
And Gary looked at me and he had tears in his eyes. She said, I don't know if I can do this. And I said, I know why. We're writing about your dad. And she put her lyric book up to her face, and she sort of lost it. And it was one of those moments where I knew we had something truly special. And I think it's one of the most moving songs on the record, and that's the one that I've just played you the saxophone for. So there are moments when you always know when you've got it.
Yeah.
When it's truly special. But because if you then capture that on record, that's it. And the world picks it up. You don't have to even think, you just literally put it on and you know straight away. It's just a magic moment.